We are the body of Christ, who stretches inward and reaches outward. A body who grows, serves, and transforms lives through the love of Jesus Christ. Welcome to Butchel Park Baptist Church. We are so glad that you have decided to join us today.
We are a body of Christ who engages all generations through diverse ministries and impactful missions. Come grow, serve, and transform lives with us.
We are growing through Bible studies, educational seminars, and prayer gatherings. Come grow with us.
We've been serving our neighbors together for almost 100 years. Come serve with us.
We worship together online and in person. Check us out at www.bpbaptist.org.
All are welcome. Come and worship with us.
All are loved. Come and find your place among us.
We want to see all God's children to know the peace of Christ. Come transform lives with us.
May the peace of Christ be with you.
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 Here at Butchel Park Baptist Church,
there is always enough room at the table for you.
Welcome to worship to both those of you in our sanctuary as well as those who are joining us online later this week. If you're a visitor with us today, we'd love to get to know you a little bit better. And there's a card in front of you in the pew, and you can put that either in the offering plate later in the service, or you can hand it to any one of our pastoral staff. Here, he's holding it up so you can see exactly what it looks like. There you go. Well, for many, summer is a time to take a step back. I hope that you have been able to maybe soak in some longer days and enjoy some version of rest. And even if you haven't been able to take a vacation somewhere, I hope that you are finding moments of Sabbath in these summer months. Time to take up what is life-giving for you and maybe put down some things that are not so life-giving, those things that consume your energy. And in this hour, I hope that you settle into a place of worship here this morning and that you allow yourself to enjoy 1 hour of Sabbath together as a body of Christ. We know that God is in this place moving among us. We know that the hands of the Creator are slowly reshaping us. We feel the embrace of Christ healing and calling us. And we feel the movement of the Spirit empowering us. Let us pass the peace to one another in community. The peace of Christ be with you. Stand and greet your neighbors in peace.
morning to everybody. Please join me in the call of worship. Sometimes God takes us where we don't expect. In worship, we gather to get in touch with God's bigger picture.
In worship, we gather to expand our hearts.
So let us worship the God of unending surprises.
Stand and join together our voices in the hymn of praise, Creator God, Creating Still. Hymn 6.
Church.
Will
you join me in a prayer of illumination? God of unending surprises. This life is like a tapestry of moments woven together. We long to be weavers of love. Today we gather and we pray that you would unravel our biases.
Unravel our assumptions. Unravel whatever it is that keeps us from you.
And as you do, clear space in our hearts for your word.
We are listening. We are praying. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We have a focus today around our garden ministry, and Luann found a song that fit just perfectly. And it says Carla Fenter's solo. I am going to sing some of it by myself, but I need your help. At the end of each section of phrase in the song, there's some words that we'd like you to sing. Thanks be to God on the first and third verses, and I will help point to you. Shelly's going to play when it's your turn to sing, so that'll kind of give you clues, and we're going to practice that here in a minute. And on the second verse, it's God's will be done is what you're going to sing. So I'd like your participation as we sing this song about creation together. So the music for your part goes like this. Let's try that with thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. That's on the first and third verse. On the second verse, it's God's will be done. Let's try that.
God's will be done.
All right, for the third of all creation.
Thank you.
our children are invited to come up down here at the front. We're going to have Miss Jan Causey and Jessica Jenkins teaching our godly play story today, which is about the parable of the sower. And so we are holding their family in our prayers. Join me together for our confession and our forgiveness. Creator God,
being faithful has never been easy.
You asked Noah to build a ship. You asked the Israelites to plant gardens and build homes while in exile. You asked the prophets to speak challenging truths. You asked the disciples to drop their nets and follow you.
And to ask us to love bigger than society wants to. Being faithful has never been easy, and as a result, we often miss the mark. Forgive us for holding tightly to human-made plans. Forgive us for the times we say no to you, so that we can say yes to ourselves. Unravel the grip we have on our agenda, so that we can make room for you.
Gratefully we pray.
Amen.
Let us stand again and sing our hymn of prayer, hymn 387, God who made us Christ, who calls us.
Thank you.
organizing the garden ministry, and so I've asked Carla to come down, and she's going to be sharing a little bit about her experience working in the garden ministry. I know many of you have heard reports about the garden, but today we wanted to focus on what her experience has been. And so, Carla, tell us about first how you got started serving in the garden ministry.
All right. I hope you don't mind me putting on another hat here this morning. This is what I wear out in the garden to protect my skin from the sun. But teaching, I never could help when I was working. I couldn't find the time to come out in the garden. But it's always something I wanted to do. I grew up going to my grandfather's farm and helping. At least he had machines to do a lot of the stuff, but I remember my cousins all out following the plows and picking up potatoes and throwing them in the truck and doing that kind of thing. And my dad had a garden beside our house where we lived, and I would help in that. And I have my own little garden at home. And so that's just always something that I've wanted to do. So that first fall when I graduated, or when I graduated, when I retired in 2018, I graduated to doing more for the church. And one of those things that I really wanted to do was the garden ministry, and I've been doing it since then. I helped that fall, and I've been helping since.
What was that first day like?
You know,
do you remember?
No. The teacher's mind or the memory brain is about gone. I really don't remember. I know I enjoyed it because I keep coming back, I guess, but I felt welcome. Everybody was so glad to see another hand to help do things. So, you know, I know it was a good experience.
I know when we were talking about this last week and what you wanted to say, you had mentioned it. She said it is such hard work. So I want to ask you, you keep saying yes.
I know.
Yeah. Why do you keep saying yes to those emails and those requests to work?
I ask myself that too sometimes, because it's not an easy thing. I was thinking about bringing in my boots to put on that I wear out in the garden, but they're a little bit muddy, so I thought I better not do that. But I believe in putting your faith into action, and I believe in working for the Lord and serving the Lord. And that's just one thing that I do is to serve him through helping in the garden ministry. And so that's what keeps bringing me back. And the people there, it's fun to work with. We talk about different things, not just the garden stuff all the time. But I guess that's why I just want to be the hands and feet of Christ.
And you certainly are, which leads me to my next question. Part of the garden ministry falls underneath, excuse me, the transforming lives section of our mission statement. So have you seen, what have you seen that this is transforming other people's lives?
Well, I thought it was wonderful with WOM, when I was able to actually go to a WOM meeting. We went to the Lord's Kitchen, which is one of the places that we help. And it was wonderful to see what they actually do and the space they have there and the quantity of people that come through that space that they take care of. So we've definitely broadened the community to not just our homebound or things that we have in the back that some of you get to share in at times, but so many places that we take the food and things to that have really stretched our community beyond this building into the West End, into Southern Indiana, lots of different places. So we have really grown our community through the garden ministry.
And that's what it's really all about.
That's what it's all about.
So sorry about this microphone. I'm trying to not hurt y'all's ears.
They're fighting with each other.
But my last question is, what would you say to somebody who's either sitting in the congregation or maybe watching this online who might be thinking, I've not volunteered in the garden ministry, or maybe I haven't in a while. What would you say to them if they were interested in getting involved?
Well, there are a lot of other things to do besides going out and doing the physical labor in the garden. So there are ways that everybody could plug in. And I'm sure dropping your email address to Suzanne or Leonard or somebody to get on that mailing list, she puts out opportunities of ways to help all the time through that list. It may not go to everyone, but it goes to a lot of people that are involved in ministry. But collecting bags, collecting the flat boxes that they need when they go to the places to distribute the food, egg cartons, there's a lot of things you can do and helping deliver to the homebound. And I think, is Sarah head of that? You're not head of that? I thought you were head. But taking to our homebound. So just letting someone know, Suzanne, Leonard, myself, anyone else. In fact, if I would say who's helped in the garden ministry, I'm sure quite a few people throughout this room would stand up that they've participated in that. So just let us know. We'll put you to work. If you like getting your hands dirty and stuff, we'll love to have you out in the garden, because that is the labor intensive part of it, is planting and reaping. And the crops, when they're ready to go, you got to go get the crops, because otherwise they'll rot and you won't have anything. So we could use more hands for that all the time, anybody that wants to serve in that way.
Absolutely. Well, thank you, Carla, and thank you to all of you. I know there are many faces out here who volunteer regularly in the garden, and you know that you are so appreciated, and there is something for all of us that we can do to participate in the garden ministry. Thank you, Carla.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 1 through 7. These are the words of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the remaining elders among the exiles, and to the priests, the prophets, and all the people to whom Nebuchadnezzar had taken into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. This was after King Jeconiah and the queen mother, the court officials, the leaders of Judah and Jerusalem, the artisans, and the smiths had departed from Jerusalem. The letter was sent by the hand of Elisha, son of Shaphan, and Jeremiah, son of Hilkiah, whom King Zedekiah of Judah sent to Babylon to King Nebuchadnezzar. It said, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat what they produce, take wives and have sons and daughters, take wives for your sons, give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there, do not decrease. Seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf. For in its welfare, you will find your welfare. This is the word of our Lord."
Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Leonard. Beloved, would you join me in prayer? Do me a favor, while you join me in prayer, could you touch someone, if they will allow me? Let's go to God together in prayer. Most gracious and loving God, we thank you for bringing us to this moment. We fought all week just to make it to Sunday, so that we might hear a word from you. Speak now, Holy Spirit. Have your way today. Hide me behind the cross and let the meditations of my heart and the words of my mouth be pleasing to your sight. Amen. Amen. Beloved, today I want to preach from the thought, searching for peace in the midst of loss. Searching for peace in the midst of loss. Beloved, on March 12th, 2020, the World Health Organization declared COVID-19 a global pandemic. Their medical advice to the public was to wash our hands with soap and water and are using hand sanitizing gel. We should already been using that. Maintain social distance while keeping a distance of 3 to 6 feet. They advised everyone to seek medical care early if you were experiencing symptoms as fever, cough, or trouble breathing. Furthermore, on April 3rd, 2020, mask requirements will go into full effect to lessen the transmission of COVID-19 in the United States. And yet, despite all of the medical advice and preventative measures that have taken place over the last year and a half, on June 15th, 2021, the U.S. reached a grim milestone of 600,000 lives lost due to COVID-19. But moreover, beloved, I'm fully aware this morning that COVID-19 is only one of many underlying causes of why we are experiencing loss in 2021. I'm aware this morning that I'm preaching to someone who has recently lost a companion. I'm preaching to someone who is troubled over your own health as you wrestle with Father Time. Perhaps you are an elderly couple or a person who has had to recently move out of the only place you called home for the last 40 years. Suddenly you find yourself in an unfamiliar place with strange faces. Friends, none of us here are exempt from experiencing loss. For the rest of us who have not experienced esteem yet, it's knocking on the door. And one thing we know for certain, that the loss we face is buried. It's consuming. It can even drain our strength. Despair, fatigue, distress, hopelessness, discouragement, unsettled. These are all words that describe what we all have been feeling the last year and a half. But beloved, I've come with some good news today, that we can make it through any loss with the real presence of God. Oh yes, we can. Just don't take my word for it, beloved. Take the words of Jesus Christ when he tells his disciples, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give the same peace that the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid." Beloved, in other words, the peace that God gives, the world can't take it away. That's good news. And those words are a reminder to you and me today, because more now than ever, peace can seem elusive and even harder to obtain when we are feeling lost at every turn. In like manner, we can draw parallels from what we see in the text and what we see going all around us today. We find ourselves in Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 1 through 7. The people of Israel have lost everything. It was the end of life as they knew it in Jerusalem. Their entire government had collapsed as a result of an invading foreign power. There is no remnant of military. There is no government. The leadership is in exile. You can imagine the people being in a state of shock, a disbelief, almost having no hope for the future. Perhaps even perplexed, we can imagine them saying to themselves, "This is not supposed to happen to us. And in response, Jeremiah writes the pastoral letter to encourage the people as they navigate their way through a new normal in a foreign land. In this letter, Jeremiah gives instructions to build houses and live in them, to plant gardens and eat what they produce. In simple terms, while in exile, miles away from home, Jeremiah tells them, make the best out of a bad situation. Friends, do you see the vital challenge in the text? This is problematic and also comforting at the same time. It is the same challenge that you and I face today. Here is the first lesson that we learn when we read the text. And here it is. It is that during loss, we can find peace. But in order to find peace, you and I must stay calm and trust God. I know it's simple, right? Now listen, I know what you're asking. I've had to wrestle with the same question myself. And the question is, how do we keep calm and trust God when everywhere we look, loss is there to greet us? We feel as if we are about to be overtaken by the mounting waves of our grief and the raging forces of our pain as they beat up on the ship of our life. But well, I want to ask you a vital question today. But before I reveal that vital question, I want to pause right here and say it is the same question Jesus asked his disciples in Mark chapter 4 as the waves are beating on the ship. And they feel as though they're about to go overboard. And so they go to find Jesus sleeping in the middle of the ship. And in their panic, they shake Jesus saying, Master, do you care if we perish? Do you see the storm raging? Do you even care if it takes us out of here? How could you sleep in a time like this? Do you even care if we lose everything we have? Have you ever asked that question of God? Have you asked God, do you even care? Jesus gets up and he wipes the sleep from his eyes. And the Bible says he puts forth his hands towards the storm, and with three words, he rebukes the wind and the sea. And he says to the wind and the sea and the storm, peace, be still. And the sea and the wind and the storm calmed. Listen, friends, what I'm trying to tell you here is that God can give you peace when you need it the most. Jesus then turns his attention to the disciples and he asks a question. It is the vital question that I want to ask you today. Do you trust him? Do you trust God enough to carry you through your loss? Lord, help me. I'm trying to preach this the best I can, but do me a favor, ask someone, do you trust God? Ask them, do you trust God? Listen, the question that we always have to answer in life is, do we trust God through every loss? Will we trust God in every letdown and every disappointment? Can we trust God in the storms of life, even when they threaten to overwhelm us with grief, sorrow, and pain? Perhaps this is the moment in our loss we can give God yesterday. I believe that God is looking for someone who will say, yes, Lord, I trust you with my life. Yes, I trust you with my family members. Yes, I trust you with my job. I trust you in this season of loss. God, I can trust you with my worries. I can trust you with my fears. I can trust you with my anxiety. I can trust you with my pain. Because that's what faith requires. Furthermore, beloved, this letter from Jeremiah is a reminder that we can trust God with everything because God can fix anything. Let me say that again, just in case you miss it. We can trust God with everything because God can fix anything. There's nothing that our God cannot handle. I must admit that I always wasn't convinced of that statement. Until my back was up against the wall. Until I lost a grandfather. Until I lost a grandmother. Until I lost a family member. I can remember we would go up in church as a child. We would often sing the song, "He's got the whole world in his hands." And at first I didn't understand as a young child why they would keep teaching us that song. And the older I become, the more I realize why we kept singing that song. It was a reminder that whatever we are carrying, we can put it in God's hands. Beloved, you need to know that whatever you may be carrying today, God can carry it for you. Friends, be not dismayed. God will take care of you. No matter what the test, God will take care of you. You can lean on the breast of God. I've come here to encourage someone today that to tell you that God is bigger than my loss. Yes, He is. God is bigger than our uncertainty. God is bigger than our fear. I remember as a young child, I would watch VeggieTales, and I remember the song, and they song they say, God is bigger than the boogeyman. God is bigger than the monster under the bed. God is bigger than my fear. And how is it, you may ask? Well, beloved, it's simple. God has the whole universe in His hands. This includes all of God's creation. That includes the unborn, the living, and the dead. We can have peace in our loss. Well, yes, we can, beloved, because we believe in a God who was wrapped in flesh and dwelt among us. He went to the cross, and for you and me, He died. Oh, beloved, but that's not how the story is. He was laid in a tomb on Friday. He rested all day Saturday, but on early Sunday morning, He got up with all power and victory in His hands. He conquered death, hell, and the grave. And that's why, beloved, we can have peace even in our loss. What shall separate us from the love of God? For neither I am persuaded, neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, neither height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Furthermore, beloved Jesus, Jeremiah says to the people, take wives for your sons, and give your daughters in marriage that they may bear sons, daughters, and multiply there, do not decrease. Friends, this is good news because Jeremiah is saying that even after we experience loss, we still have a future. In other words, Jeremiah is instructing the people to take part in God's redeeming work on earth, to remain faithful to our mission that seeks to be a church committed to growing, serving, and transforming lives. This is why we declare today Mission Sunday. Because we are a church that understands that even in our loss, God still calls us to be fruitful in our living, to be fruitful in our resources and our talents, so that God's will is done on earth as it is in heaven. Future Park, we have been steadfast and faithful in our stewardship of supplying food and supplies to those in need. We witnessed this in our garden ministry as they continue to harvest over 5,118 pounds of vegetables for our community. Additionally, we see this in other ministries, for example, for our women's own missions, making sure that children in our community have school supplies and coats for the winter. We partner with organizations like Day of the Care and Stamps for the Wounded. We have a beautiful program called Parents Day Out, and we provide a space for children to learn and grow and be nurtured in the love of God, no matter what they believe, no matter where they come from, no matter how much money they make. Beloved, I can go on and on, but this is what I believe when Jeremiah was talking about when he says, plant gardens, eat what they produce. Be fruitful, do not decrease. And so here is our final challenge in the text. Jeremiah instructs the people saying, seek the peace of the city where I have sent you, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in this peace, you shall have peace. And Jeremiah instructs them to seek peace, not just for themselves, but for others who might believe, think, and live differently. Perhaps as we endure our loss of family members, companions, life as it once was, church as usual, we are being called to share the peace of Christ with all of God's creation. Because where there is peace, there lies hope. Where there is peace, there is love, there is healing, there is grace, there is joy. May we share the peace of Christ with one another today. Would you do me a favor, beloved? Would you stand and share the peace of Christ with someone today? Go ahead. Do that for me. Let's share the peace of Christ with one another today. As you share the peace of Christ with someone. As you share the peace of Christ with someone, let them know that they can make it. Let them know that there is help for the helpless. But this is not the end. That you can make it. God's got the whole world in his hands. Amen. Amen. Right. You join me in the affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the great sower, who weaves us together in community, collecting our loose ends and turning them into belongings. Who hems us in before and behind, catching us when we fall and writing us into God's holy narrative.
I believe in Jesus Christ.
Who loved and claimed the people society has thrown out, refusing to disregard anyone as proud. I believe God has woven parts of God's self in to the fiber of our being, making us inherently worthy of love and the law.
I believe the fabric of my life is
weak. That I am prone to error. I need God's handiwork to remind me of love. I believe in the church, and that like a quilt of different fabrics, she is designed to be as diverse and beautiful as God's creation. God is there to stitch our wounds together, to hold me in the palm of God's hand, and to tell me of love, and to invite me into a new journey. Amen. Beloved, as we respond, during the hymn of response, if you would, if you feel led to by the Holy Spirit, you are invited to come up and grab one of these sheets. And whatever you are holding on today, whatever you are carrying today, I invite you to put it on this cloth and put it on the cross as a symbol that you are putting whatever you are carrying in the hands of God today.
Let us stand and sing hymn 477. We are called to be God's people.
For Bible studies on Sundays and Thursdays.
Subscribe to our emails and our newsletter mailouts.
Get involved in our amazing music ministries.
Engage your family in our wonderful youth and children's programs.
We want you to be invested.
We want you to be connected.
Here at Butchel Park Baptist Church,
we are
an inclusive community of faith.
rooted in the love of Jesus Christ.
Grow,
serving,
and transforming lives.